So it's not very complex, it's not very different from how you go about finding anything else. But I think in the case of a house, there's a little bit more detailing that's involved. So it's more about, I think the key is in the first conversation and actually having a detailed first conversation explaining, and it's a two-way thing. It's about explaining from our side, explaining to people what to expect in Bombay and what not to expect in Bombay. And vice versa from the side of the clients explaining to us what they want and what they don't. To give you a very simple example, let's say you are two young guys moving into Bombay from another city, or a young couple moving into Bombay from another city, and let's say you have a fairly rich budget of 50,000 rupees for a 2 BHK. The options, and assuming that you work, you know, anywhere between BKC to Nariman Point, or now you have a lot of people working in Goregaon, Malad. I think broadly, the key decisions you need to make are you going to be willing to adopt train travel in the city, or are you going to drive? Are you the kind of guy who goes out? Are you and your wife going to go out in the evening and eat out frequently because you're newly married and you're looking to move into the city? Or are you people who have a lot of friends and family over and hence don't mind the commute, or maybe you have your parents living with you, in which case you need a larger place? And especially if you're moving in from another city like a Delhi or a Bangalore, because Delhi, Bangalore and Bombay seem to have a lot of people moving between the three of them. And depending on the answer to each of these three questions, your areas get isolated. So for example, if you want to save a bit of money, live in a reasonably decent place and don't mind travelling by train, maybe your options are around Vileparle, Khar, Bandra East, Mahim. On the other hand, if you like to go out, meet a lot of friends, socialize, do a lot of new things, especially early in your life, then Bandra is clearly the answer. But at 50k in Bandra, you won't find a house that's nice or half as nice as the ones you find in the other places. The locality compensates, but you might not have a fixed parking, or there'll be some traffic flaw with a house at 50k. Or if you want to move out and take a lot of space, you're coming in from Bangalore where the minimum house size that you see is a floor layout of 1300 square feet, then it's pretty much not available anywhere in Bombay, and you need to go into a Powai or a Chandivali or a Chembur and be willing to commute by car and not take up the train service. So I think this is essentially the key to the process, which is to understand what you're looking for. Are you going to be sharing it with a friend? Are both of you going to be moving in? Are you working in the same company? Because otherwise you have other issues, like one guy could be posted out, could move jobs, and have another guy replace it, which has implications on the lock-in, the negotiations you have with the landlord, do you have your own furniture? And I think it's in this detail that a lot of the success or failure of a job hunt, of a house hunt, lies. So we try and engage with clients in detail, and what we found is the amount of time we put in before we go out to the first house hunt is the key to whether that house hunt is successful.
So I think the step one would start off with either people calling us or they have contact us number, which is there on the website, or through emails. So either they call us, where we basically attend and kind of take down all of these specs of what Kendall is mentioning about in terms of requirements of area, locality, family, they're looking for what kind of building, whether they're looking for a multi-story, etc., all of that. So that's broadly the first step of what we connect with. Post that, essentially we have our relationship manager, who essentially kind of connects with the tenant, who essentially will kind of put it in the down in terms of more specifications, we might have a perspective on area, etc. And then post that, we kind of do our first travel of work in terms of the site visits, where we kind of show them apartments which kind of matches their needs. That's the third stage. Usually we do ranges of around 2 to 3 rounds in terms of what he likes and what he doesn't like. Ideally, we look at closing somewhere between 2 to 3 rounds. And post that, we essentially attend to the entire documentation, which includes the legal registration, police notification, etc., all of that. And we also do help in terms of doing the basic parts of moving in and trying to help them in any of those facilities. So broadly, it's kind of a four-step process. First, they kind of connect us to an email or phone. Then we kind of call them and kind of counsel them as what we were discussing. we have an RM who kind of takes in the actual offline visits and do all of that. And then we have the documentation movement. So broadly, these would be the four blocks of what happens at both of these schools in a nutshell. So most of them are a mixture of both. To answer that point a little more in terms of, we are a little choosy about whom we take and whom we don't. So the ones which we take, most likely we are able to close almost 70-80% of them, the ones which we pick. We are very picky about whom we pick, because otherwise we'll end up spending a lot of time just on the street where either the client is really not looking for an apartment, or in either which ways it's not a win-win for both.
What he means by not looking for an apartment is there's a lot of people who will have 5 months to go.
Yeah.
And properties move very quickly in Bombay. So they say, you know, we're moving in, we're currently living in a house, we have a lease running out in December, let's do weekend shopping. And, you know, what we say is that we run a fairly tight outfit. There's a lot of brokers out there that are willing to do that. But we don't do that largely because, you know, it is very frustrating for both the relationship manager and the client, because a lot of landlords will not show you properties which someone looking for in December. So the only way to show them those properties is to actually lie, either obviously lie or lie, commit a sin of omission or a sin of commission. So you either say, you know, this guy is looking for it, and show them the place and then try and talk his way through it, or you say, you know, you omit talking about it, in which case pretty much amounts to the same thing. Because just as much the responsibility we have to the clients is the same responsibility we have to the landlord. So, you know, it is a two-way. There's this mythical belief that there's this great deal that people find in property. And I don't think that really exists. I think property is a fairly arbitraged out commodity. So, for example, if you look at the Wadala complex, last month you had a significant move there where those 3 acres, at least 7 or 8 of the 10 buildings in those 3 acres said they wouldn't take bachelors or single people anymore. And the moment that happened, literally from the next day, Bhakti Park rose by 5,000, and that difference moved up where those 3 acres was prime to Bhakti. But immediately you knew that everybody who works in town or works in Lower Parel, which is where the financial industry, the clustered jobs in the financial industry are, you know that all those single people are now the lawyers, the financial guys, all of them are now going to move from Dosti to a Bhakti Park. And immediately, it was almost instant, the notice got put up there in Bhakti Park, we were in the middle of a deal and the price rose. So there isn't that much arbitrage in property. Property prices are what they are for a reason. So you see these wonderful houses in Mount Mary, and all of them will be at 75k, and you see this one single house that is wonderful, fully furnished, and it's at 55k and will jump. But the reason it will be at 55k is because there will be a water problem in that building. And I think people have a difficult time appreciating this. So it's actually a lot of the value that we have is when we build that trust with the client, or he's coming in through a reference and saying, this is the value that you can provide. Today, we can hunt down property in pretty much any part of the city. But really the game is about, and if that is not the value added, and if people are looking to, you know, save on the last 1,000 rupees, or so we found places where people are okay with 70,000 as a budget, and we found a great house and not do it at 72,000. And to me, that's just a shame. It indicates that, you know, this is not our kind of client. So we're fairly clear in who our kind of clients are and who they aren't. And I think actually we spend zero on SEO and on online marketing. I think what is amazing is how, for people with the right intent, the web is actually a wonderfully supportive place, if you will. I love the new Google Chrome ad where, you know, they have the Tanjore painting and someone sells it. But I think Google also keeps refining and doing the right thing. So for example, we've tracked our site visit numbers and they've gone up fairly consistently. And I think if you have genuine content, I think Google Analytics and Google Indexing does a fabulous job, where I think by default it will take care of the fact that your website will grow in popularity if you have enough content to attract people. So the reason we don't spend money in SEO is because I think we've taken the call that SEO by itself, I mean, Google is consistently trying to beat this. I mean, the whole Panda rules that came in last year, where, you know, they started tracking not just how many people come in, but how much time people spend on your site when they come in. I mean, I think we've taken the call that, you know, in order to do relevant online marketing, we've done the numbers on that, and I think if you don't have a couple of crores at least to blow away, it really isn't worth it. There's no point paying homage to the god of SEO and putting your penny on the temple of the great SEO god in the sky. So we basically say, you know, we'll do this the way we want to do it, which is through extensibility and the tough way. We won't do SEO for the heck of doing SEO. We've done a bit. It's not like we haven't done a bit. I mean, you run a fabulous website yourself inside IAM, and I think you would have seen the same benefits of having genuine content, and this content that people come in for. So we've done the meta tagging and, you know, writing up stuff and ensuring our URLs are submittable, and we've done the basics and set things up the right way. But as far as, you know, begging people for pack links or spending money on getting people to like your Facebook or calling people up, my best friend doesn't like my Brokers Please Excuse Facebook page, because it's not something that people do naturally, and we don't believe in, you know. So when I go out and see a young startup that has 7,000 likes, I know he's either spent money or spent an inordinate amount of time on something that I don't think is relevant to business. So we basically focus on, you know, doing business and ensuring that clients are happy and clients are satisfied. And if that is true, we believe a lot of this stuff will take care of itself. There might come a point in time when, you know, we have a team that is starving for leads, but currently our problem is the other way around. We have too many leads and too few RMs. And so when we come to that point, hopefully we will figure out how to do SEO and all this wonderful thing that will help us become a pan-India.